Good evening, everyone. Having been a priest for over 40 years, I know that at the end of any service, we head for the doors like somebody yelled plague, myself included, when I go to a service when I'm on vacation. So I just wanted to say a few words now after we've prayed the rosary together and before Father talks. Thank you all so very much for being here these past days, these past holy days. And I'm really, really grateful. These have been some of the biggest crowds we've had since pre-COVID. So thank you all for being here. May I ask who is from a neighboring parish or a parish other than St. Ignatius, just to raise your hand? Well, thank you all. And please know, I don't want to take you from your own faith communities, but if you ever need a community of faith, we'd love to have you here. And you're welcome to worship here, but God bless you for coming and for being with us. You're not going to believe this, but over the last 2 to 3 months, Father Bill has given about 10 missions all over the East Coast. And he does a beautiful job, and we need together to thank him for his energy, his enthusiasm, and his faith, and for inspiring us as we get ready for the great holy days of the church year. So, Father Bill, thank you so very much. So, God bless you all, and we're in for a treat now.
Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.
I may as well take this moment to thank Monsignor publicly because he has been such a gracious host to me in working with me all along and making sure that I'm aware of everything that's happening and getting me to meet with the staff. And I'm so very grateful, Monsignor. Also grateful for those who volunteered, Jack and Seta, especially to sell the CDs each evening. And thanks to Sue for the delicious food that we've had at the rectory. Okay, so number 453 is Come Holy Ghost, 453. So I'd like us to sing the first two verses of Come Holy Ghost. So let's stand up. Standing for our opening prayer to the Holy Spirit. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful and kindle in them the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit, and they shall be created, and you shall renew the face of the earth. Let us pray. O God, who by the light of the Spirit did instruct the hearts of your faithful, grant that by the same Holy Spirit we may be truly wise and ever enjoy his consolation. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. So two men were golfing on a course that was located right next to a cemetery. And just as the one was about to putt, he noticed a hearse turning into the long driveway of the cemetery. So immediately, he laid down his putter, removed his cap, and bowed his head for a few moments of silence. Then he returned his attention to his game and sunk the putt. His buddy was really amazed at this. Gosh, I just didn't realize that you had such respect for the departed. And the man said, well, it's the least I could do. She was my wife for 40 years. How can you laugh? That's horrible. Horrible. It's the least I can do, he says. And we know, I know I'm preaching to the choir here, but we know a lot of people who, as Catholics, even as Christians, are really just doing the least they can do. They are surviving. Sometimes that's all we can do either. But the Lord is calling us to more than survival on planet Earth. We have to be good stewards. He's calling us to thrive. I came that you might have life and have it to the full and have it abundantly. I would say that one of the great obstacles are the wounds that we have and the attachments that we have. They keep us from thriving in the Christian life. So I'm going to sing a song now by George Harrison. This is a post-Beatles song, and it's called Give Me Love. Remember last evening I said I kind of wanted to create a trilogy of faith, hope, and love? Well, I'm going to have to try to work hard to explain love, but I think the Lord's heart of healing is a heart of love. So Harrison sang a song in 1975 called Give Me Love, Give Me Peace on Earth. And I will tell you that I'm going to change one word in the song. If you're familiar with it, you might know. I'll explain it afterwards because it makes perfect sense if you change one word. Thank you. Changed. Well, let me just give you a little background on Harrison. Harrison, you know, passed away about almost 20 years ago of brain cancer. And he was the quiet Beatle. He was baptized Catholic, as was Paul McCartney. You probably didn't know that, but they were from Liverpool, and Liverpool was a port city, and therefore a great many Catholics in Liverpool, England. But somewhere along the line, Harrison drifted, and he got himself into Eastern mysticism, Hinduism. I read a story where he was telling the story that his mother, who was a devout Catholic, was really concerned about him. And he writes a letter back to his mother, "Oh, mother, don't worry, I still believe in the Sacred Heart." Interesting. He wanted to have it all, I guess, you know. But he didn't quite get it right. Because if the word that I changed in the song was, you know, it goes, "Give me love, give me love, give me peace on earth, give me light, give me life, keep me free from birth," is what the song says. I changed it to "keep me free from hurt." And I'll explain why. But for him, as a Hindu, the idea was you don't want to be born, because to be born means you're not reaching moksha. It means you're being reincarnated and possibly as a lower life form. If you didn't live properly in the current life form, then you might wind up as like a frog or something in the next life. So keep me free from having to be birthed again in reincarnation so that I can reach moksha, which is the height of happiness, I suppose, in the Hindu religion. It's a little bit like maybe nirvana in Buddhism, but it has no association with what we understand to be eternal life with the Holy Trinity, okay? But I think by just simply changing the word to "keep me free from hurt," that's okay. That doesn't mean "keep me free from suffering." That's impossible. In fact, St. Augustine says that it's precisely because we're Christians that we can expect to suffer more in this world. So we will bear up our burdens. We will carry our crosses. We will accept sacrifices as disciples of our Lord, joining in his salvific offering to the Father. Yes, we will do that, but we don't pray to be hurt. Nobody wants to be hurt, right? Doesn't that make sense? Yes, we'll accept suffering, and when it comes that we didn't expect it, we try to surrender to it, but nobody goes and looks to be hurt. That there would be something wrong with us. And yet, maybe sometimes we do, because we're wounded deep within. And Jesus wants to bring his healing touch to those areas that are wounded. So let's stand and read the gospel that we were supposed to look at this evening. The Lord be with you.
With
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come with her weeping, he became perturbed and deeply troubled, and said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Sir, come and see." And Jesus wept. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him?" But some of them said, "Could not the one who opened the eyes of the blind man have done something so that this man would not have died?" So Jesus, perturbed again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay across it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the dead man's sister, said to him, "Lord, by now there will be a stench. He has been dead for 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone, and Jesus raised his eyes and said, "Father, I thank you for hearing me. I know that you always hear me. But because of the crowd here, I have said this, that they may believe that you sent me." And when he had said this, he cried out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, tied hand and foot with burial bands, and his face was wrapped in a cloth. So Jesus said to them, "Untie him and let him go." The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. This is where love comes in. This was not play acting. Let me bring on a few tears and really make it look good for the drama of it. And Jesus wept. That's the shortest verse in all the Bible. 3 words. And Jesus wept. Genuinely. Because he had a genuine human heart. Even though his personhood is the second person of the Trinity from all eternity. He took that heart so that he could weep for you and me and say, "Untie them and let them go." There's something wrong in the ministry of the church if people don't feel that they've been freed, if they don't feel that they've been healed. They'll go looking somewhere else for the healing if they're not going to experience it in the church. All the things that the apostles did in the Acts of the Apostles were showing that because the Spirit was with them, they could do the same things that Jesus did. And they were expected to. Well, nothing has changed. We're all called to receive the healing power of Jesus. Now, he has given us the sacraments to do this. He's given us the saints to intercede for us. He's given us people who have healing gifts, and he's raised up healing ministries in the church. There are a couple of points in that gospel that are salient, that are poignant for us to consider. The first one is, oh Lord, he's been dead, you know, there's going to be a stench if we move that stone. Well, what about the stone that's covering our hearts so that we don't get hurt again? Or maybe it's a stone that someone else rolled in front of our hearts, and we're afraid that if it's removed, there's going to be a stench. If people know who I really am and what I've done, stench. Okay. Another point for us to consider is that even after Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead, he was still tied up. I don't know how he got out of the tomb all tied up. You know, did he hop out or something? I don't know. It's a little hard to understand, but somehow or other, he was still bound head to toe. And that's why Jesus said, "Untie him and let him go." Now, the point for our consideration is we may be baptized, confirmed, going to Holy Eucharist every Sunday. We've lived a whole life long of Catholicism, and yet it's possible that there still might be areas of our lives that are tied up in knots. And Jesus says, untie them and let them go. So we're going to explore this a little bit, and I'm going to draw upon the work of Dr. Bob Shooks, who has the St. John Paul II Healing Center in Tallahassee, Florida. He's a devout layman with a healing ministry and a psychologist, and he's written books. One of them I often recommend in the confessional, called Be Healed. If you just type that into Amazon, I am sure within the first five, that book is going to show up. It's not a thick book, but it's loaded with power of insight. You don't have to try to remember his name, Bob Shooks. If you just remember Be Healed, you're going to see it and say, oh yeah, there's that name. And I recommend it. He says, and he's drawing on some other people's work as well, that we come to confession and we confess our bad fruit or the rotten fruit that's part of our life. And we hand it over to Jesus and he takes care of it, right? In a sense. But Dr. Bob asks the question, okay, we deal with the bad fruit, but what about the bad root? Where is it coming from? What is the root that has to be dealt with that's propelling us into these patterns of acting out, these patterns of sin, these patterns of just barely surviving when Jesus wants us to thrive? So he comes up with seven. Just like there are seven deadly sins, pride, lust, anger, envy, sloth, greed, gluttony, or you could put them into a modern format, pride, I need to be right. Lust, I need to be liked. Anger, I need to be in control. Gluttony, I need to be pleased. Envy, I need to be first. Sloth, I need a break. You know, and greed, I deserve this. All, I'm just putting modern expressions into the capital, the seven capital sins. So Dr. Bob says there are seven deadly wounds. And when they occur in our life, not everybody has all seven, but sometimes they happen as you're growing up in various ways. You get wounded. And then here's the problem. Because the wound hasn't really been exposed to the air and to the light of the Holy Spirit, it festers, and then we end up believing lies about ourselves. We end up agreeing to falsehoods about ourselves that undermine our true identity. After all, this mission is all about entering into our true sonhood or daughterhood as children of the Father. So I'm going to list the seven, and then I'll go back and explain what the lies are that we associate, that we end up believing about ourselves because these sorts of events happen in our life. I'll read them off first. Rejection, abandonment, hopelessness, powerlessness, confusion, fear, and shame. And there are demons that like to lock us in to those wounded events and memories in our life. I don't want to explain every single one of those. I think they're pretty explanatory, but let me take one. Abandonment. Let's say you're 8 years old and you were told that your father was going to pick you up at school and he didn't come. He never came. And finally, your teacher had to take you home. And you wonder, what's going on? You're 8 years old. And then it happens another time. And then you realize that Dad never shows up at the games. And then when you get to be 12, whatever, you realize that, Dad has a drinking problem, that Dad is an alcoholic, and he's not there for you. Abandonment wound, okay? So, or rejection. You try to fit in with the group of kids, and they don't like you because you just moved into their school, and you're different. Rejection, wound. I could go through all of them, but I'm not going to. Let's go in through the lies that we believe. All right, let's start with rejection. When I'm wounded in rejection, I believe the lie that I am unwanted, unlovable, not good enough, and that lovableness is the result of my pleasing others. And so I bend over backwards all the time. I must be a pleaser. When I'm under the wound of abandonment, I believe the lie that I'm alone, that no one understands me or cares for me. Even God forgets me. When I'm under the wound of hopelessness, I believe the lie that nothing ever changes, that life is meaningless. At least, nothing ever goes my way. When I'm under the wound of powerlessness, I believe the lie that I am weak, stuck, trapped, unable to measure up, especially when things are out of control. When I'm under the wound of confusion, I believe the lie that I can't make any choices until I figure out every possible consequence and understand every possible angle. And hence, I really never do decide. When I'm under the wound of fear, I believe the lie that I'm unprotected, that I must always be anxious and look out after myself because people want to hurt me. Life is full of danger, you know. When I'm under the wound of shame, I believe the lie that I'm bad, I'm dirty, I'm ugly, I'm stupid, I'm worthless, I'm perverted because of what I look like, because of the things that I've done, or because of the ways that people treated me. You see, when all of these wounds are active and all of these lies are active in us, how are we going to thrive? What we need to do is rebuke, reject, and renounce these lies. And so I'm going to coach you through that and then pray a prayer of healing for you. And I didn't have time to print it out, so I've got to use my phone to do it. All right. Now, you may not feel comfortable with this. You don't have to participate, but if you want to, I mean, as I just read through that list, you're probably trying the shoe on. You're thinking to yourself, you know what? That's bullseye for me. So, I would like you, if you feel comfortable, to just repeat after me. Lord Jesus, calling upon the power of your blood, the power of your holy name, of your high priesthood, under the mantle of your mother, the Virgin Mary, I reject. I renounce, I rebuke all the evil spirits that try to keep me locked into lies that I end up believing because I have been rejected, abandoned, hopeless, powerless, confused, afraid, and ashamed. I command that all these evil spirits and any related to them go to the foot of your cross, where you can deal with them. You have the victory. I thank you, Lord. Amen. And now, having done that, I'm going to pray a prayer of healing for you. Dear Lord, I know that there is no sickness that you cannot heal. You know all things, you can do all things, and you love all your sons and daughters here this evening. With faith in your promise that whatever we ask in prayer, you will grant us if it will be good for our souls, I come before you to ask for healing of body, mind, and emotions and spirit for your people tonight. Touch them now where they are hurting most. Only you know what kind of healing they need most right now. Let the grace of your divine love flow in and spread to the different parts of their bodies, reaching the inner recesses of their being, comforting them in their pain and anguish. Correct any malfunctioning of their body organs. Melt with your healing love any abnormal growths. Arrest all further spreading of all sick cells and replace them with healthy ones. Root out all unresolved hurts, resentments, fears, and feelings of despair and frustration. Heal all painful memories and repercussions of traumatic experiences. Grant them the grace to accept their trials and sufferings as a share in your own sufferings for their souls and those of their families and loved ones. Forgive them for all their sins and fill them with your love, peace, joy, kindness, and generosity. Let them realize the deeper meaning of their sickness and trial and lead them closer to you to find comfort in your loving heart. Let them find joy and peace amid their suffering with the eyes of faith. See the blessing and the victory that await them. And then, Father, after they have been healed and see you face to face, may they rejoice forever to praise your glory and your wonderful plan fulfilled through Christ our Lord. Amen. Wonderful. All right, now I'm going to sing a song that I wrote about 20 some odd years ago. And it's a song that came to me out of dealing with some people who had some deep wounds in their life, and in particular, who had suffered sexual abuse. So the title of this song is, This is Why Jesus Came.
Blind old fool, be silent, let the master be. Will he hear me? Lost in my darkness, all my life I have longed for this. Lord, I want to heal the blind and the lame, to preach good news to the poor, and to set the captives free. to feel the depth of your pain, to give you strength to endure, and to give you the victory. They will stone her if the master lets them. In the sand he begins to draw. He who is sinless, cast a stone. A woman who condemns you, no one, sir, she answers. Neither do I condemn you, but go and sin no more. This is why Jesus came, to heal the blind and the lame, to preach good news to the poor, and to set the captives free. This is why Jesus came, to feel the depth of your pain, to give you strength to endure, and to lead you to victory. Go tell John what you hear and see. The deaf can hear and the lame walk free. Lepers are cleansed, the dead are raised. Those who once were blind now see. To feel the depth of your pain, to give you strength to endure, and to lead you to victory.
Yeshua, Messiah,
up and take a break and greet those around you. Okay. Are we doing good? All right. Well, let's go ahead and be seated. And let me point out that there's a basket, a free will offering basket with these little purple envelopes that you could throw something in. If it's a check, it needs to be made out to St. Ignatius. And this will benefit the Dominicans, our formation program, the preaching ministry that I have. If you're not prepared, you're here tonight first time, you didn't know, what I've done is I have my own official envelope, and you could grab it and mail. Look, we've been at this for 800 years, folks. I mean, we kind of have it down. So if you're not prepared, you can mail something to us. And these envelopes are on the table in the lobby where the CDs are being sold. These two CDs, the song I just sang, This Is Why, is on Preacher of Grace. This is the only place you can find it. It's not on this because I didn't sing it 3 years ago when I came here. This is the mission I gave 3 years ago, the black and white CD. Preacher of Grace, half the songs I wrote. The other half are Don Francisco, the Devil Song by Keith Green, Adam, Where Are You? He's Alive, and other things, okay? And if you want to follow my ministry, my website is DominicanPreachers.org, all one word, DominicanPreachers.org. And that also has the link, if you go there, it has the link to my YouTube channel. There are about 85 videos there, homilies. Well, 15 of them are actually me doing songs that I did last year in a parish while COVID had everything shut down in terms of my ministry. It also has a calendar of where I'm going to be in the future. And if you're from other parishes in the area, feel free to go to my website, get the information, and tell the person who arranges those things in your parishes to consider having me come. Because I would rather, since I'm located in Washington, D.C., and my mother, who's 96, lives in Hagerstown, I'd much rather be in the area here than as I was 2 months in the South. Well, I do like being in the South during the cold, but I'll have to think about that. Anyway, thank you for your generosity to the collection. I will be hearing confessions one last time this evening, and the hymn board, where the hymn board is actually the beginning of the confession line and every pew behind it. So folks that are sitting in that area, if you don't want to go to confession, you'll need to scoot out when we close so that the people who do want to go to confession can be sitting from the hymn board all the way back. And you don't remain in the same spot. When the first person gets up, everybody has to shift, the Catholic scooch, see? You gotta move around so that you are at the sign when it's your turn. Does that make sense? Just wanna keep it moving quickly so that I can hear as many as possible, all right? All right, did I cover everything that I wanted to say to you? Yes, so now I'm gonna sing a song that was sung by a group in the early 70s by the name of Bread. But David Gates was the great songwriter for Bread, and he wrote this one called Everything I Own. And you'll recognize it if you don't recognize the title. But you could be mistaken when you hear this on easy listening radio. You might think he's singing about his girlfriend. I give everything I own to have you back, babe. You know, he doesn't say babe. As a matter of fact, he wrote the song right after his father's funeral. He wrote it about his father. So it might take on a different hue for you, knowing that. It's a little too much reverb. See, I'm my own sound man.
Sheltered me from harm, kept me warm. You gave my life to me, set me free. The finest years I ever knew are all the years I had with you, and I would give anything I own, give up my I would give everything I own just to have you back again. You taught me how to love what it's of, what it's of. You never said too much, but still you showed the way, and I knew from watching you. Nobody else could ever know the part of me that can't let go. And I would give everything I own, give up my life, my heart, my home. I would give everything I have you back again. Is there someone you know, you're loving them so, but taking them all for granted? You may lose them one day, someone takes them away, and they don't hear the words you long to say. And I would give anything I own, give up my life, my heart, my home. I would give everything I own just to have you back again, just to touch you once again.
No, it's a powerful song, and it means more to me. My father died 14 years ago, so. But why play a song like that? Because Jesus has given everything he owned. He gave his whole life on earth. He gave himself in miracles and in teachings. He gave his mother from the cross. He gave his life on the cross. He has given us the communion of saints, those who are in heaven, those in purgatory, and those of us who are struggling along the way. Yes, Jesus has given us everything he owns to have us back again, once again, to touch us once again. And he touches us every time we receive his sacraments. Yes. And why? Because he loves us. Not because we're good, but because he's good. See, he doesn't wait for us to earn it before he loves us. Untie them and let them go. And the truth is, my friends, we can't untie anyone else if we're all tied up. And he wants us to help untie other people. My mother rescued me 3 times. I was 2 months old. She gave me cow's milk for the first time, and I went into anaphylactic shock. She called the doctor. "Do you have any bee sting medicine?" "Yes." "Give it to him." Snapped me out of it, or I wouldn't be here today. Fast forward 2.5 years later, I'm a toddler, and we're all going down to Florida in our camper. We pull into a rest stop, in the section where buses and campers and trailway buses and tractor trailers park. My dad opens up the door. He was driving. The kids, I'm the youngest of eight, they all bound out because we all went on this trip, 1967. And I'm bounding down the stairs just as a huge trailway bus is coming. My mother was right behind me, so from the bottom step, I'm already on the ground. She reaches down so quick, all the way below the proper level, and lifts me up and throws her back out and saves my life. Then I was 12 years old and receiving allergy shots. My mother's a nurse, and I had a reaction. I was out with the boys, and I noticed I was starting, this was just about a half hour, you're supposed to wait an hour, and I didn't. So about a half hour in, I started closing up and couldn't breathe, and I ran to Mom, I can't breathe. She pulled out the adrenaline. We didn't have EpiPens back then, and she snapped me out of it again. Actually, there was a fourth time. I was 6 years old, and we had a clothes shoot in our house, and I think my sister made me a dare. I dare ya. And it was in the floor, the second floor, in the floor, lifted it up. I got in that thing, and I got down this far. Now, I'm a little six-year-old, and I knew, uh-oh, I'm in trouble. So I screamed out, Mom, or my sister did. She ran in there and grabbed me by the shirt and gave me a whack and said, get to bed. True story. You know, when you've been rescued, you appreciate it. If you've been part of a rescue, you appreciate it. Ronald Reagan suffered from Alzheimer's at the end of his life, and the story is told in one of the biographies that he was with someone walking through the corridor to his study where all the pictures were on the wall, the photographs with him greeting popes and prime ministers and kings and queens and other presidents and ambassadors. He didn't remember a single one of those photographs. Then he stopped in front of a picture of him as a teenager lifeguard. And he paused and he said, I saved 77 people. And he had. He never forgot the rescue. Did you see Mel Gibson's Hacksaw Ridge? True story. Private First Class Desmond Doss, a medic in the Army, Seventh-day Adventist, did not want to carry arms, took a lot of abuse. They tried to throw him out of the Army, but he fought and he stayed and he rescued a lot of people in the Battle of Okinawa. There was a cliff, I guess that's why the, you know, Hacksaw Ridge. They got up there and the Allies were gunned down, outnumbered, and they fought. They fell. And the wounded were being lowered over the cliff down to the beach. But nobody knew who was doing it. It was Private Desmond Doss. And as he was doing it, he would say, one more soul, Lord. Help me save one more. He saved 75 guys. And apparently, one of the ones that he saved is the one who was up there hearing him say, one more soul, Lord, one more soul. When you've been touched by the rescue of Christ, when you've been untied, you want to spread it up, you want to spread it around. And I know that you're carrying the burden of a lot of your family members having drifted from the faith. I suggest you take up Our Lady, Undoer of Knots. Pope Francis has brought our attention to that novena. Look it up online. I suggest you get a hold of Dr. Bob Shook's book. I suggest that you, if you don't have the practice of praying the rosary, take it up. Start praying it. Father, it's just so difficult. Well, then you don't run the marathon without training. So start out doing a decade of the rosary, and then you can build up to it, to the whole thing. Or the Divine Mercy Chaplet, which takes a third of the time it would take to pray the rosary. You still use the rosary beads. All of these ways of lifting up our loved ones and those who stand in need of rescue. You know, on the beach, you see all kinds of sizes and shapes, you know, of seashells. Of people. Yes, of people. But one thing you never see on a beach is an out-of-shape lifeguard. They're always fit. So let's be fit. Let's fast, let's intercede, and let's trust in God's timing. Fasting can be fasting from technology. It doesn't have to be food. That's where so many people are losing their identity these days. So why not do a little fasting from technology and interceding with others? Have a crew. If there's a rescue to happen, the lifeguards blow the whistle and they get the other lifeguards in on it. They need backup. We need to pray with one another. This is a very active parish. If you're not part of a prayer group, you ought to consider it. And if there isn't one of your particular flavor, why don't you start it? Okay? Let's be fit. Let's intercede. Or rather, let's fast, let's intercede, and let's trust in God's timing. And let's make sure that we take advantage of the sacramental life where Jesus touches us. I recommend 4 times a year, seasonal. If businesses and corporations have to make quarterly reports to shareholders for their accountability, why can't we do that spiritually? It's just a rule of thumb. I know Our Lady says in some apparitions monthly. I go more than monthly. The Pope goes weekly, apparently. So how about aiming for 4 times a year, the seasons? You know, we already do, a lot of people already do it in Advent and Lent, which is basically winter and spring. Let's put summer in there and let's put the fall in there. Sorry to be making more work for you, Monsignor, but... Let's keep that in mind. Okay. Well, the Lord promises us the power of the Holy Spirit as we experience His untying and healing power in our lives. And He raises us up. So I'm going to end with one song that you're very familiar with, and then we're all going to pray that prayer of renewal together. And a little bonus, I decided to go ahead and set up the first-class relic of St. John Paul II that I had here 3 years ago. So anyone can come up here afterwards and pray in front of the relic. What is it? It's a piece of the white papal robe stained with his blood from the day that he was shot, May 13th, 1981. So it's the blood that makes it a first-class relic. Now, if you come up here and pray, just be mindful that there are a lot of people who might want to pray, so don't pitch camp and, you know, hold a retreat. Just, you know, make your prayers and go ahead and move on. I really don't want people touching the relic right now. Venerate from a distance. We'll get past this in the end, and then we'll be able to get back to that kind of kissing of a relic, okay? So the last song, I meant to write down the author's name. I think of Rolf. I always want to say Olofsson because it's some kind of Norwegian name and some Patrick Graham. It was a duo that wrote it. They were part of a group. I should be fired for doing this to these guys. But they were part of a group called Secret Garden. And they wrote a song called You Raise Me Up. And everybody else seems to know it, but it's been copied and covered by lots of different people, but especially Josh Groban. And I'm going to try to follow the Secret Garden kind of arrangement of how this song goes.
Thank you.
my soul so weary. When troubles come and my heart wander, then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas.
Okay, let's take our sheet, the brown sheet, and pray together the prayer of renewal. If you can kneel, that would be good. If not, just remain seated. And we'll add on prayers for the intentions of Pope Francis, that is the Our Father, Hail Mary, and Glory Be, for the conditions of a plenary indulgence. Together now. Lord Jesus, you are the Savior of my life. With my whole heart, I desire to live in your radiant light. I wish to enjoy forever the fellowship of your saints. I firmly reject the dominion of darkness and beg you by the power of your blood shed on the cross to forgive my sins and cleanse me from all my guilt. I promise, with your gracious help, to follow you ever more closely, trusting only in your abundant mercy. Stir up the gifts of the Holy Spirit in my soul, that I may cry out with you, Abba, Father, Grant that I may find inspiration and strength through prayer, that I may experience your abiding presence in the sacraments, that I may be guided by the truth of your word, which comes to us in scripture and tradition. Help me to forgive and serve others as you have forgiven and served me. Help me to use the gifts you have given me to build up your one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. In all my trials, help me to trust that you will never abandon me. Lord Jesus, when my life on earth is complete, send your Holy Mother Mary to lead me to the eternal home of our Heavenly Father, together with Saint Joseph and all the saints. I ask all this in your holy and glorious name, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. And now the Our Father. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Please stand. And now we have the solemn blessing which closes the mission. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. O Lord, save your people and bless your inheritance. O Lord, hear our prayer and let our cry come unto you. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, give us help from your holy place and graciously hear the prayers of this people, asking pardon of their sins with humility of heart and waiting for your grace. In your goodness, stretch your right hand over them, and pour upon them the fullness of your divine blessing, that being thus filled with all good things, they may obtain everlasting happiness and life through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. And may the peace and blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit descend upon you and remain with you forever and ever.
Amen.
This mission is ended. Go in the peace of Christ. Thanks be to God. And let's just close with the Immaculate Mary hymn that's on your sheet.
Immaculate Mary.
God bless you all. Drive safely, and I'll make my way to the confessional in a moment.
Thank you.